Good morning, dear students and fellow educators. Welcome back to the second session of biology. The chapter that we are discussing, biotechnology, the unit 6, rather unit 4 of our syllabus. Before I start what we have planned for today, let's take a very quick recap of yesterday's presentation. So this is from where we started yesterday. Just a definition of biotechnology. This was a technique of using live microbes. So that was the key word here. Then the branches of biotechnology, traditional and modern. Modern biotechnology has genetic and cultural biotechnology, genetic engineering and cultural technology. In genetic engineering, we carry out genetic manipulations. In culture technology, we grow the microbes in the labs. The basic processes, these are the basic processes involved in the creation of a recombinant DNA. The first one, we take a target DNA, we take a vector DNA, that is plasmid in this case. We cut both of these using the same restriction enzyme, produce the sticky ends. These sticky ends hybridize, forming hydrogen bonds. Then these are ligated by using the enzyme ligase. So we create a recombinant DNA. This recombinant DNA is transferred into a host. This process of transferring the recombinant DNA into the host is called transformation. After we select the proper transformed organism, the one which has been transformed, then it is cloned for large scale production and then downstream processing for its extraction and utilization of that product. The first step was the extraction of DNA. The steps are like remove the cell wall, remove the cell membrane, remove RNA, remove DNA, remove RNA, remove proteins, precipitate DNA with the help of ethanol, cold ethanol, ice cold, and then spool it out. After that, this technique, electrophoresis, is used to isolate the fragments. These fragments are separated according to their charge and mass. Then from the gel, these are eluted and then processed further. The restriction enzymes, this is how they act. They cut at a particular site, which you call restriction site. These restriction sites, they are sticky. So that means we can join two different DNAs from two different sources, produce a recombinant DNA by using ligase. Then we discussed the features and nomenclatures of restriction enzymes. Like restriction enzymes are found in bacteria, naturally found in bacteria, and they form the defense system of the bacteria. The ways of nomenclature, so we took the example of ECOR1. So E refers to the first alphabet, is the genus. CO, the second two, they refer to the species of the bacteria. So Escherichia E. coli CO, Escherichia coli. R refers to the strain, RY13. And 1, that means from ECO RY13, this is the first restriction enzyme to be isolated. Then we talked about the cloning vectors, the definition and the features. Cloning vectors, piece of DNA that is required to transfer the host into the, transfer the foreign DNA into a host cell. There are features, the specific features, the minimum essential features. We expect these three features to be present in any vector, cloning vector. That is, there must be an origin of replication from where the DNA can start the replication. Otherwise, it will be lost from the system. There should be a selectable marker which can help us in identifying the transformed host, and there should be cloning sites where the foreign DNA can be ligated. Some examples, plasmid-based, artificial chromosomes, and retroviruses. This is an augmentation, I'll say. It is now the agrobacterium vector. How it works, you can see it better here. that this is the agrobacterium, the soil bacterium. It is found naturally in the soil. So we take this agrobacterium and take out its plasmid, that is a TI plasmid. TI plasmid, the most important aspect of this bacterium is TI plasmid. Tumor inducing plasmid, it has a T-DNA. This T-DNA, if we cut it from here using a particular restriction enzyme, and in this site a foreign DNA is inserted and ligated, now we have a recombinant TI plasmid. This recombinant TI plasmid can now be inserted into another bacteria, obviously, because this bacteria is already killed. We have removed the cell wall, the cell contents, everything. So that means it doesn't exist. This is a different bacterium in which the T-DNA has got a foreign DNA, recombinant DNA. This recombinant DNA is now transferred into another agrobacterium. Here, this was now infected to the plant cell. Once it enters the plant cell, it has a very unique ability that it inserts its DNA into the host chromosome. So because it inserts the own DNA into the host cell, so along with the host cell, its DNA also keeps on multiplying and producing the product. So that is the use of agrobacterium tumefaciens, that is plant vector. So now let's start with the competent host. Actually, we are talking about the process of transformation. So till now we have discussed the isolation of DNA, then cutting the DNA, joining the DNA to produce a recombinant DNA. Now this recombinant DNA needs to be transferred into a suitable host. This process is called transformation. If the host accepts the foreign DNA, it is called now a transformed host. But the host will not accept the DNA for free. It wants some treatment. In other words, we have to make the host competent. So any host just randomly cannot be picked up and DNA can be transferred. The host has first to be made competent. So by definition, competent host is the one which accepts the foreign DNA, which is ready to accept the foreign DNA. So in order to make the host competent, we have to treat first it with some chemicals. Mainly, it is the calcium ion. So around 50 micromolar concentration of calcium ion works for this purpose. The host cells treated with a specific concentration of divalent cation, that is calcium, and this will increase the efficiency of the cell to pick up the DNA, because there will be holes, there will be pores in the cell wall, transient pores, not the permanent ones. Only for a fraction of seconds these pores are created and then they seal. Meanwhile, the DNA can enter. While the holes are still there, we can do the other treatment, the second phase of treatment, that we subject the cell to heat shock. So recombinant DNA can then be forced into these cells by incubating the cells with recombinant DNA on ice. So here the temperature is around 4 degrees Celsius, followed by placing them suddenly, see, at 42 degrees Celsius. So from 4 degrees, it is suddenly transferred to 42 degrees Celsius. So this comes as a shock to the bacterium, to the host. That's why we call the heat shock. And this enables the bacteria to take up, or the host to take up the DNA. So now the host is ready to pick up the DNA. Now there are different methods. Methods are many, but let's go by the syllabus. So according to syllabus, direct method of transformation, and this is simplest method and the earliest method. In this method, the bacterial cells are grown in the nutrient medium, in the culture medium, and In that medium, the recombinant DNA is left just like that. So there are chances that during the process of replication, when the bacterial cells are dividing by binary fission, the foreign DNA might enter into the cell. And you can make out from this description yourself that this process is not a very sure method of transformation. It all depends on chance. But this was the very first method of transformation available in the initial stages of recombinant DNA technology. Now we have moved way beyond these methods. We have lots of sophisticated methods. The first after that is the electroporation. And here the term electro is important. So the cells are given electric shock. The medium in which they are growing, electric shock is passed for a fraction of seconds. High voltage for a fraction of seconds. This also creates the holes in the cell membrane. Through these holes, the foreign DNA can easily enter the cell. Another method, and you can see it is a mechanical method, micro injection method. So DNA is loaded into a needle, micro needle. Micro injection is then injected into the cell, so the nucleus directly accepts the foreign DNA. And the extreme is something like saying enough is enough. Biolistic or the gene gun, the final solution. So the DNA is coated on microparticles, the beads of gold or tungsten. And then these beads are shot, literally shot, into the target cell under high velocity. This method in particular is very useful for plant cells because they have got a cell wall. Other methods can work with animal cell, plant cell and all, but biolistic or the gene gun method works very well with the plant cells, just because these particles, the gold or tungsten beads, they can easily be shot into the cell. We can represent it diagrammatically also, the entire process of transformation. The direct method of transformation, the DNA is directly entering, the transformed DNA, the recombinant DNA is directly entering. No external agency or nothing, no special effort was made. This, the gun, shooting it directly, these particles coated with the DNA, directly taking the beads inside the cell. Then this is the micro injection. So it's a micro pipette actually. We hold the cell in place properly. So once it is stable, then only it can be injected. And you can draw a very common analogy from your daily life. Suppose some child has to be given some injection. Now the child has to be okay, held in place by 2-3 people around. So that is what? These cells, they have to be held in place. Then only the micropipettes can be used for injecting the material. We also used the viruses for transferring the genetic material into the cell. And this was the electroporation. See, before the electrode applied, the lipid layer is pretty stable. The nanoparticles bearing the recombinant DNA, they are also around. Once we apply the electric pulse, then this lipid layer becomes unstable, and due to this, these particles take the advantage of the situation and they go inside. Now after the pulse has passed over, the membrane re-stabilizes, comes back to its normal shape. So once we have transferred the foreign DNA, now we have to find out which one is the host which has actually been transformed. So imagine a situation like this. We don't do with any single cell. This is a culture plate containing many cells. We left the DNA here. Recombinant DNA was transferred into this petri dish in the medium. So among these many cells, which one has actually picked up the foreign DNA? That is actually called the selection of recombinant. Because the one which will pick up will be a transformed host. So we have to select the transformed host. Who is the one which has got it? So this we decided right in the beginning when we use our vector. In the vector we made provision for this. There was selectable marker, provision for selectable marker. So selectable marker was for this purpose only. That from the whole population, which is the actual transform, select it. This direct selection method, it depends on the presence of antibiotic resistance gene in the vector. So here we are taking the example ampicillin resistance gene. So if the vector is having the ampicillin resistance gene and it is transferred, it is like the host has got this ampicillin resistance gene. So others, the non-transformed hosts, will not be resistant, so to say they will be sensitive. Whereas the one which is transformed will be resistant to action of ampicillin. So this is how it works. This is how diagrammatically you can see that this was the plasmid where the gene of resistance, antibiotic resistance, is present. This was the vector in which the foreign DNA was inserted. So recombinant DNA was created. So this recombinant DNA, take note that along with the antibiotic resistance, it has a foreign gene. So both are present. Now, if we transfer it into the host and just assume there are many hosts, I don't exactly know which one has the ampicillin resistance gene. And ampicillin resistance gene means what? Which one has actually my DNA of interest? So for this, what we do, we take these cells and grow in petri dishes. Petri dishes containing nutrient medium, along with the nutrient medium, the antibiotic. In this case, ampicillin. So this plate is containing ampicillin. And if we transfer all these colonies, so the observation is this, that only these two colonies, this one and this one, only these two colonies are able to grow. The others, you can see, they have disappeared completely from the scene. Why have they disappeared? Just because they did not have the gene for the resistance. And how come do they have? So they don't have it on their own. We provided them. And we provided them just to make sure that the DNA is here. So now, these bacteria are the transformed ones. These host cells are the transformed ones. So we selected the transformed and eliminated the non-transformed. So now this is grown, cultured, DNA purified, extracted, or whatever process we have to follow, now we follow. But we were able to select. We were able to screen. So that's why it is also called screening. This is the technique. The bacteria are growing. Two types of plates. One, the normal medium, the other containing antibiotic. When they are grown in the normal medium without antibiotic, all of them grow successfully. But here you can see 1, 2, 3, 4 colonies only. Why? Because these are the ones which have the resistance gene, antibiotic resistance gene. And how come, where from do they got it? So we provided it. We provided it along with the gene of interest. So that is how now these are the transformed hosts. Others, non-transformed, eliminated. So we selected. Every time antibiotic selection doesn't work. So there are some methods which are based on a different method, different principle. That is called the blue-white method. This is actually an extension, you can say, of the insertional inactivation method. This insertional inactivation method is based on the resistance against antibiotics, not one, two antibiotics. If you remember, EcoR1, so in EcoR1 there are two selectable markers, one for ampicillin resistance and the other for tetracycline resistance. If you are using the restriction enzyme selectively to cut either this or this, suppose we have selected SAL1, so you cut this one and the foreign DNA is inserted here. So imagine the recombinant one will lose the resistance against tetracycline because its tetracycline gene has been disrupted. Whereas this one, the ampicillin resistance, it will still be there. So here the principle is that the non-transformed ones are able to survive in the presence of tetracycline as well as ampicillin. But here is a different method. Here, the transformed ones are able to survive in presence of ampicillin, but not in the presence of tetracycline. So that was the principle. Thankfully, we don't have it in our syllabus this year. But on this principle, the blue-white method of selection is based, because two antibiotics and culturing, subculturing, growing the culture plates, master plates, replica plates, it was a very cumbersome process. So just to avoid it, we have selected another method that is based on utilizing the LacZ gene's coding ability. It codes for the enzyme beta-galactosidase. So on that ability, on that principle remains the same, methodology is the difference. So what is that? So remember, I'll have to take you to that part first. Lac operon, you all have studied. One of the members of lac operon, one of the structural genes of lac operon is beta-galactosidase coding gene, LacZ. LacZ codes for beta-galactosidase, which hydrolyzes lactose into glucose and galactose. But whether lactose has been converted into glucose and galactose or not, we cannot see with naked eyes. We'll have to do lots of biochemical analysis and that. But here in this method, what we have done, that in place of lactose, we are using a synthetic analog of lactose, that is XGAL. So XGAL is a synthetic analog of lactose. So the enzyme beta-galactosidase cannot discriminate. It just cannot make out whether it is acting on lactose or on XGAL. So it finds the bond, galactoside bond here, and that glycosidic bond is broken. But our advantage is that when XGAL is metabolized, when it is hydrolyzed, then it is converted into a blue color product. So blue colored product, now that is very clearly visible to the naked eyes. So that means XGAL has been metabolized because the enzyme was functional. Enzyme was functional because the gene was properly coding for the enzyme. Now imagine a situation. We disrupt the gene coding for beta-galactosidase. Then bacteria will not be able to produce fully functional beta-galactosidase. Then it will not be able to convert XGAL into colored substrate, colored product. So this colorless substrate will not be converted into a colored product. One more information, that XGAL on metabolism changes into a colored product. That's why it is called a chromogenic substrate. XGAL is called a chromogenic, color yielding substrate. This is how it works. see the entire process. What is done here? We have taken a plasmid. In this plasmid, this is the gene. This is the gene that is marked. This is the position of the LacZ gene. And this is the foreign DNA, the gene of interest that we want to insert. So these are the three situations possible. We have to ligate it. And then it will be transformed. Let's see what are the possibilities. So if this foreign DNA is inserted within this sequence, causing this gene to be disrupted. Now some part of the nucleotides are here and some part of nucleotides are here. In between, a foreign DNA has been inserted. So this is inactive. Second possibility, that this is inserted somewhere else. Third possibility, it is not inserted at all. See here, what is the fate? Try to analyze yourself, take some time. White and blue and blue. So if we are able to insert it at a proper place, now it will code for an enzyme, but that enzyme will be non-functional enzyme. So it will not be able to convert X-gal into colored product. So the colonies will remain white. And in these two cases, this gene is intact, fully intact. So it will code for a fully functional enzyme. It will convert X-gal into blue colonies. That means no transformation. So what is the principle? The fact is that white and blue, which one we have to select, which one is actually the transformed? So white is transformed because this has picked up foreign DNA, enzyme is inactivated. Others have not, so they are non-transformed. So that is the principle of blue-white selection. In the presence of X-gal, the host cells which carry the recombinant plasmid will form white colored colonies. And those which carry non-recombinant DNA will form blue colored colonies. So this is the summary of it. After this, one very important aspect of rDNA technology is the amplification of gene of interest. There are two methods by which we can transform. We can make copies. So amplification of gene of interest, it means getting many copies of gene of interest, because when we are processing, there are chances that DNA may be lost. So as a backup, we have lots of copies of gene of interest. For getting that, these copies of interest, there are two methods, one in vivo method and the other in vitro method. So PCR is an in vitro method of gene amplification. Just one line. PCR, the polymerase chain reaction, is an in vitro method of amplification of gene of interest. And this technique was developed by Carey Mulis. What we do? So multiple copies of gene of interest are synthesized. That is why this is also called molecular photocopying. This technique, PCR technique, is also called molecular photocopying. There are certain requirements. One, tacked DNA polymerase, and this is the most important component. Most important component, I'm saying. Without tacked polymerase, this entire technique would have just not been possible. So tacked DNA polymerase, here TAC stands for Thermus Aquaticus. Remember this name, Thermus Aquaticus. This is the bacteria from where the DNA polymerase has been isolated. Now, why only Thermus aquaticus? Why not Escherichia coli? Why not any easily available bacterium? Because Thermus aquaticus is found in hot water springs. It's not easily available. So that makes it unique. Hot water spring makes it unique. If you see, we are going to discuss in future, just a few slides after, that we have to use lots of temperature changes. 90 degrees Celsius, 50 degrees Celsius, 70 degrees Celsius, or the range. Now, at this temperature range, you cannot expect a normal enzyme to remain active because enzymes are heat sensitive. So, TAC polymerase is one enzyme which is stable, thermostable. The ones which are sensitive, these are called thermolabile. So, this is not thermolabile. TAC polymerase is thermostable, means it can withstand high temperatures up to the range of 90 to 95, 97 degrees Celsius. Whether other normal enzymes will be denatured, this enzyme still remains intact. So, the TAC polymerase is the key enzyme. All just one in one line, TAC polymerase is the key enzyme of PCR reaction. The steps are fixed. You can see what we do in this step. First step is denaturation. The target DNA is heated to a temperature of around 90 to 95, 6, 7. So there is a range. Why I'm giving you a range? You can analyze it sometime that all DNAs don't have same number of A and T and C and G bases. And that affects their stability, the TM, the melting temperature. So accordingly, this temperature is decided. For each DNA, the temperature is slightly different. We can't say that, okay, only 90 degrees. It can be 91, it can be 92, and so on. So once we heat the DNA to this temperature in this range, the two strands separate. Now each strand is ready to act as a template. Now the temperature is brought down from 95 to around 55, 60 degrees. At this temperature, you'll find that oligonucleotide primers, which you already had added in the system, these primers start annealing with the DNA and annealing with the 3' end of each template of the DNA. So this is called annealing or renaturation. Primer annealing or renaturation. Now the temperature is increased again, and this time to around 72 degrees Celsius. At this temperature, the TAC DNA polymerase takes over. It starts adding the complementary nitrogenous bases according to the template and starts extending the primer. Once the primer is extended, that means the DNA is being synthesized on the complementary strand. So this way, we got two DNA strands. But that was one cycle. If we repeat the process, now these two DNA molecules, which we got in the first cycle, they will act as the templates in their turn. On heating, they will separate. Now we'll be having four templates. Each other template will now be subjected to same reaction, primer extension. By the primer extension, it will become double-stranded. So that means now we have four complete DNA molecules. So if you follow the third cycle, all these four, they will separate. So that means now we'll have eight templates. See how the number is growing. From one DNA, we got two. From two, we got four. From four, we got 8, 16, 32, 64, 128, so on. So we can calculate. The cycles are repeated in the same way to get more DNA products. There can be a question that if a DNA molecule is subjected to four cycles, how many DNA molecules we produced in the system. Or conversely, the other way around, for producing 256 DNA molecules, how many cycles will be required? And because each cycle, as we saw just now, depends on temperature. Graphically, you can see that this was the template, the original DNA molecule, the target DNA molecule. This target DNA molecule was subjected to heat treatment. The strands separated. They will now act as templates. For that, we'll have to bring the temperature down. The primers will anneal. Primers will hybridize. If you find annealing a difficult word, you can simply say that primers hybridize. Once the primers have hybridized, temperature is raised. Now the TAC polymerase causes the extension of this primer and adds complementary nitrogenous bases according to these sequences. So we get two molecules of DNA. Now cycle is followed again. So denaturation, primer annealing, polymerase extension, they form the cycle, polymerase reaction, polymerase chain reaction. That's why we use the word chain reaction. The device in which we do it, it follows a cycle of temperature. It is set 95, 70 and 72. So that machine is called thermocycler. That machine is called thermocycler. The machine which is used to produce DNA in this way, the polymerase chain reaction. So polymerase chain reaction machine, we don't have to use this word. We can simply say the thermocycler. Thermocycler is the polymerase chain reaction machine. To make the things still clear, I'll show you a small video. And here you can see how this entire process works for a clear concept. So let's see what happens in this process. Polymerase chain reaction.
Polymerase chain reaction, PCR, enables researchers to produce millions of copies of a specific DNA sequence in 1 to 2 hours. This automated process bypasses the need to use bacteria for amplifying DNA.
Please take care here itself. This automated process bypasses the need to use bacteria for amplifying DNA. This is actually referring to the in vivo amplification. So in vivo amplification has its limitation. It's a time dependent process. And this process in vitro, so it's very fast. Within a few hours, you must have seen here, 1 to 2 hours, the entire process is completed.
A PCR reaction starts with a denaturing step. Samples are heated to 94 to 96 degrees Celsius for 30 seconds or more to denature or separate into single strands, the target DNA. Next, the temperature is lowered to 50 to 65 degrees Celsius for 30 seconds or more. This allows the left and right primers to anneal to their complementary sequences. The primers are designed to bracket the DNA region to be amplified. The temperature is raised to 72 degrees Celsius for 30 seconds or more. This allows the TAC polymerase to bind at each primed site and extend or synthesize a new DNA strand. The temperature is raised to 94 to 96 degrees Celsius, denaturing the target DNA as in cycle one. As before, the temperature cools to 50 to 65 degrees Celsius, allowing more primers to anneal. The temperature is again raised to 72 degrees Celsius. TAC polymerase binds to each primed site and synthesizes a new DNA strand. In subsequent cycles, the process of denaturing, annealing, and extending are repeated to make additional DNA copies. After three cycles, the target sequence defined by the primers begins to accumulate. After 30 cycles, as many as a billion copies of the target sequence are produced from a single starting molecule.
So that's it. So after the technique, let's talk about the application. Why at all do we do this? As I said in the beginning, this is an in vitro method of amplification. So why to amplify? So amplify, gene cloning, fingerprinting, diagnosis of genetic diseases, diagnosis of viral diseases, and take a pause, think about the prevalent situation these days. And the method of diagnosis, if you remember, is called RT-PCR. So RT-PCR, it is just a variation of the same technique. Real-time PCR. So advantage is what? That earlier the viral diseases, they were not diagnosed early. But now with the advent of this technique, we can diagnose it very fast. Then it can be used for the creation of gene libraries, for studying the phylogenetic relationship, evolutionary relationship among the organisms. This is actually one type of in vivo amplification. Along with in vivo, there are some other aspects also, which are other targets also, which we can achieve by using bioreactors. So bioreactors can be used for in vivo production, in vivo gene amplification, that is called the organismal cloning. Like if you got a recombinant bacteria, and if we are allowing the bacteria to grow under ideal conditions in a bioreactor, actually we are doing the gene cloning, that is in vivo cloning, so in vivo gene amplification. And additional is that if we have some product as a target, we can obtain this process, obtain the target in the bioreactor. So bioreactor, also called the fermenter, bioreactors or fermenters. Till now, whatever we did, all that was done, discussed at a small level, at a laboratory level. But to make it commercially viable process, we need to obtain large quantities. The products need to be obtained in large quantities. So here comes the bioreactor. So for that purpose, bioreactors are useful. These are large vessels. The volume you can see, 100 to 1000 liters, in which raw materials are biologically converted. That is the key, biologically converted into specific products using microbes, plants, animal cells, or of course, even the human cells. Advantage with the bioreactor is that because of large size, we have to control, and then if we control, we get lots of products in large quantities. So it provides the optimal condition for achieving the desired product. For this, we have to provide optimum conditions like proper temperature, proper pH, sufficient quantity of substrate, the ions, minerals, vitamins, oxygen, and so on. A bioreactor, an ideal, a typical bioreactor, will have all these systems. It has an agitator to mix the contents uniformly, oxygen delivery system because the cells will require oxygen, foaming because this is one process. Once organisms start producing some byproducts, foam is produced. So there must be a system to control the foam. Otherwise, it cuts the foam from the organism, from the medium. So their nutrient supply, oxygen supply, all is hindered, all is affected. Proper temperature, because organisms are very sensitive to temperature, pH control system, and then input and output ports. So all this, you can show it like this. This can just be a diagram based question. Draw a diagram of a bioreactor and label the parts. So this is a large vessel, There is a motor to stir the contents, a stirrer here. There are baffles which help in mixing. They do not allow the vertex to develop. There are several ports to maintain acid and base and all these factors. Sterilization, there is a provision for a sterilization. There is input device and products can be taken out here. So this was simple stirred tank bioreactor, meaning there are two types of bioreactors that we are going to discuss. One is the simple stirred tank bioreactor. It facilitates even mixing and oxygen availability because there is a stirrer here. So that's why simple stirred tank. Now there is another type of bioreactor which we call the sparged tank bioreactor. So here the sparged tank bioreactor, you can see along with the stirrer, of course that has to be there. The baffles also are there. Different ports and all those devices are there. Along with this, the extra thing is that there is an inlet for passing the compressed air. And you should assume it. I thought, just to remind you, that this air has to be sterile air. It's not that direct atmospheric air is entered. You can ask yourself a question. What if directly from the atmosphere we transfer the air into it without filtering? So microbes will contaminate it. That's why this air has to be sterile air. This sterile air comes here and it is broken into bubbles. Once these bubbles start rising from here, then they increase the efficiency of mixing and, more important, supply of oxygen. So if the organism that is growing here, the microbes or any cell that is growing here, if their requirement is high for oxygen, then a stirred tank may not suffice. We'll have to use the sparged tank bioreactor. So one advantage is that it has greater efficiency of aeration. You can see here, in the simple stirred tank bioreactor, stirrer facilitates uniform availability of oxygen and facilitates proper mixing of contents. With both these facilities available, there is an extra facility available here. That a sparged stir tank air sparger is used to break the incoming air into small bubbles. And then these bubbles make the difference to increase the surface area for oxygen transfer. So that is the advantage of the sparger. To conclude the process, we come to the downstream processing. After all is done, you run your bioreactor for a given period of time. Now the time has come to harvest the product. So for harvesting, whatever steps we are doing, all collectively called as downstream processing. After completion of biosynthetic stage in the bioreactor, the product has to be subjected to a series of processes before it is ready for marketing as a finished product. These processes are collectively referred to as downstream processing. Many steps are involved in this. We have to separate the substance, the product from the bioreactor, we have to take it and separate. We have to purify. Then some preservative needs to be added so that it has a longer shelf life. And before it goes to the general masses, there must be quality control testing and toxicity studies. Once it clears all these, then only it is ready for marketing. It also has to be subjected to clinical trials. If it is a drug, remember this. If it is a drug, like vaccine that people are talking about these days, so there must be clinical trials, phase 1, phase 2, phase 3, all kinds of clinical studies. We cannot say, in the end, we cannot say that we have just one method, all a blanket statement for all, it applies for all. No. Downstream processing differs from product to product. For example, for ethanol, the process will be different. For extracting cheese, the process will be different. For making a vaccine, the process will be different, but basics will remain the same. The method of separation might differ, method of purification might differ, but you have to separate, you have to purify, you have to add preservative. So these are the some processes which need to be done with some changes here and there. From the next part, I'll take very quickly you through application of biotechnology. In application, whatever we studied, whatever theoretical knowledge we gained, that knowledge is used for obtaining different products. And this has been used, you can see, for getting different areas, for getting hormones, for gene therapy, in the plants also, for getting insect resistant products, BT cotton, all of must have heard about it. So BT cotton, the BT gene, that is from Bacillus thuringiensis, the gene is taken and inserted into the host plant cell. Then the host plant cell becomes resistant. One very common question that comes from here, that how come the BT toxin, although it is a toxic substance, it does not affect the plant cell and the bacterial cell which produces it. So the reason is one-liner, that the pH. The toxin is inactive in crystalline state at a lower pH, relatively lower pH. At a pH of 7, 7.4 that it gets in bacteria or the plant cell, it remains in a crystalline form. But the moment insects take it up in their gut, due to alkaline pH, it becomes soluble. And over there, lots of problems are created. It creates holes in the cells, water enters, the cells are damaged, the insects die. So selectively it is killing. And see the selectivity. Cry1AC, Cry2AB. For cotton bollworm, Cry1AB for corn borer. So how specific it is. So this is one advantage, that it does not kill the non-target species as it happens with the chemical pesticides. Another area, insulin production. Insulin production, this is the entire natural insulin, native insulin, long insulin, lots of chain amino acids. We need only chain A and chain B. So these genes coding for chain A and chain B, these are used. This C peptide, you know, this is always deleted. So mature insulin has only A and B. So why to carry the C gene? So this gene and this peptide removed. Only chain A, chain B. These are cloned in two separate bacteria. We get the recombinant proteins. We extract chain A, chain B. And these chains, when they are brought together, they form the insulin. And the last, the gene therapy, treatment of genetic diseases. Earlier, it was not even thought of. Now we have successfully tried for SCID, severe combined immunodeficiency caused due to deficiency of adenosine deaminase, ADA. See how it was done. The cells are removed from the patient, the stem cells, the lymphocytes. These lymphocytes are infected with a virus vector, retrovirus vector, we discussed last time, which is having the healthy gene, ADA, normal functioning gene. When this virus infects the cell, now the cell has got the gene which was not working properly. Now these cells are inserted back into the person is now cured of it, but temporarily, not forever. We'll have to do this process again and again and again. So, I won't let you go without a gift from my side. So, today's assignment, you can see there are some questions. I'm sure you must have tried the questions that we did yesterday, the phase one. So, happy learning. Now I invite the questions if you have any. Okay, the first question, DNA cannot pass directly through the cell membrane. Why? Because DNA is negatively charged, DNA is hydrophilic, cells have their cell membranes, and the cell membranes, they have a bilipid layer, lipid bilayer. So lipid bilayer is hydrophobic. So hydrophobic cannot interact with hydrophilic. That's why it cannot enter directly. We have to use lots of devices. All right, next question is also there. Why is Agrobacterium tumefaciens sometimes called as a natural genetic engineer? Natural genetic engineer because it transfers the genes naturally. Once the bacteria goes inside the host cell, now it does not need any electroporation, any calcium mediated transfer. It has a natural ability to transfer its DNA into the host. So if it is transferred, naturally the host is transformed. So the bacteria did the genetic engineering. So that's why we call it natural genetic engineer of the plants. Another question based on Agrobacterium. Can Agrobacterium tumefaciens be used as a vector for all type of plants? No, not all types of plants. There is a limitation, there is a restriction that it can be used only for dicots. It does not work with monocots. So one more question, what is the role of primers in PCR? Actually, this is a very basic concept related to DNA replication. In DNA replication, whenever the process starts, the normal nucleotides, the nucleotides which are added, they need actually a 3' end, free 3' end. So that is provided by the primer. And if you have noted, we require 2 primers because we have got 2 strands now and both will have their 3' end separate. Oh, I answered it in the first question. How many sets of primers are required? 2 sets. One for 5', 3', the other for 3', 5'. But both will anneal at 3' ends. How does a stirred tank bioreactor differ from a sparged tank bioreactor? Stirred tank does not provide as much oxygen as was provided by the stirred tank. So this is the advantage of the sparger, that it provides efficient oxygenation. This is one advantage over the stirred tank bioreactor. Limitations of gene therapy. What is the limitation of gene therapy? This is the question. And the limitation is that we have to use it multiple times. It's not a permanent cure, because when we are transferring the gene, we are transferring it into an individual after birth. By that time, all the cells have all differentiated and they are all working their own functions. Now they don't take up the DNA into their own. So what happens? So long as the cells containing the foreign DNA is multiplying, the effects can be seen. After that, you'll have to do the process again. You have to repeat it. So it has to be repeated. One more question is, what are recombinant proteins? Simple. If there is a recombinant DNA and if it codes for recombinant protein, so that protein will be called a recombinant protein, because that will be having proteins from 2 different sources, because the DNA is from 2 different sources. So accordingly, there will be a hybrid protein. So like DNA hybridized from 2 different sources. So if both the fragments are coding for the proteins, then the proteins also will be from 2 different sources. Can insulin hormone be isolated from other mammals? Yes, and be injected into humans. Actually, it was done before Eli Lilly started producing humulin. That is the human insulin. The human insulin that they named was humulin. That was the human insulin produced by genetic engineering. But it's not that. Before that, people were not given the injections of insulin. These insulin molecules were actually extracted from pancreas of calf and cattle and other animals and the pig. But the problem was that this insulin was not exactly the same as human insulin. So effects were shown, of course, but sometimes some people develop allergic symptoms. That's why genetic engineering came into play and produced that recombinant DNA technology insulin, the Humulin. Now that is exactly human insulin. No allergy, same efficacy. Okay, I'll take the last question today now. So last question for the day. What is the role of ADA enzyme? Okay, ADA enzyme, adenosine deaminase enzyme. ADA enzyme, if asking what is the use, so it is used to induce the differentiation of B and T lymphocytes. That is why, if you analyze, I discussed it while discussing gene therapy, that those individuals who suffer from SCID disease, they are deficient in this enzyme. So in these individuals, T cells and B cells cannot differentiate. That's why we call severe combined immunodeficiency syndrome disease. That disease is combined deficiency of T and T lymphocytes and B lymphocytes. So ADA, just to sum it up, ADA induces differentiation of T and B lymphocytes. Thank you.